prophet Isaiah. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call him while he is near. Let the scoundrel forsake his way, and the wicked his thoughts. Let him turn to the Lord for mercy, to our God who is generous and forgiving. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways, says the Lord. As high as the heavens are above the earth, so high are my ways above your ways, and my thoughts above your thoughts. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Philippians. Brothers and sisters, Christ will be magnified in my body, whether by life or by death. For to me, life is Christ, and death is gain. If I go on living in the flesh, that means fruitful labor for me, and I do not know which I shall choose. I am caught between the two. I long to depart this life and be with Christ, for that is far better. Yet that I remain in the flesh is more necessary for your benefit. Only conduct yourselves in a way worthy of the gospel of Christ. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. be with you.
And with your spirit.
Reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord.
Jesus told his disciples this parable. The kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out at dawn to hire laborers for his vineyard. After agreeing with them for the usual daily wage, he sent them out into his vineyard. Going out about 9 o'clock, the landowner saw others standing idle in the marketplace, and he said to them, "You too, go into my vineyard, and I will give you what is just." So they went off. And he went out again around noon and around 3 o'clock and did likewise. Going out about 5 o'clock, the landowner found others standing around and said to them, "Why do you stand here idle all day?" And they answered, "Because no one has hired us." He said to them, "You too, go into my vineyard." When it was evening, the owner of the vineyard said to his foreman, "Summon the laborers and give them their pay, beginning with the last and ending with the first." When those who had started about 5 o'clock came, each received the usual daily wage. So when the first came, they thought they would receive more, but each of them also got the usual daily wage. And on receiving it, they grumbled against the landowner, saying, "These last ones worked only 1 hour. You have made them equal to us, who bore the day's burden and heat." He said to one of them in reply, "My friend, I am not cheating you. Did you not agree with me for the usual? Take what is yours and go. What if I wish to give this last one the same as you? Or am I not free to do as I wish with my own money? Are you envious because I am generous? Thus the last will be first, and the first will be last." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
First of all, I'd like to thank Bishop Stowe and Karen Abbey, the Chancellor of the Diocese, and Father Danny for giving me this opportunity to speak to you this morning. My name is Father Tom Carroll. I am a Piarist father. That's spelled P-I-A-R-I-S-T. I pronounce it Piarist. Like where you put a boat in a pier, then put an IST on the end of it. I just say it the way because I've been introduced as a parish father, purist father, pianist father, and once even as a pirate father. Piarist is the way we say our name. Like many groups of priests, we take the vows of poverty, chastity, and obedience, but we also take a fourth vow, and that is to educate youth. So wherever we go in the world, we open up schools. Back at Easter of 1988, the Piarist Fathers in the United States had a meeting at their school outside Philadelphia. And there they made a decision to open up a new school. They put down two conditions that had to be met. First, it had to be in a place where it was impossible for Catholics of high school age to receive a Catholic high school education. And there are many places in our country like that. Second condition, it had to be in one of the poorest areas of our country. For a couple of reasons, our attention was being drawn to eastern Kentucky, part of Appalachia. One of the reasons that caught our attention was an article in the United States News and World Report, which in that year, 1988, ranked Kentucky last in the quality of its educational programs. Then we learned there was a new diocese being formed, the Diocese of Lexington. So we thought, be nice belonging to a new diocese. Kind of grow along with it. So we approached the Bishop of Lexington, told him our plans, and asked him where in his diocese, which is made up of 50 counties, where should we look to establish a school? He says, I want you to take a look at the Big Sandy region. And the Big Sandy is a river that separates Kentucky from West Virginia, so I'll talk about as far east in our state as you can go. The Big Sandy region is made up of 6 counties. It's about 100 miles north to south, 50 miles east to west. When we went there to check it out, we found the poverty we expected to find because it's part of Appalachia. But we learned a couple of other things too. That they really have only 2 employers, the coal industry, and by that I don't mean just the mining of coal, but those that truck it, those that make and repair the machinery used in the mines, and the school districts, which are, for the most part, countywide. And unless a person knows somebody in the coal industry or on the school board, they have very little chance of getting a job by which they can support a family. Catholics in the area, number less than 0.5% of the population. There are more Catholics at this mass than in any county in eastern Kentucky. There were 3 parishes, 5 mission churches, and 3 diocesan priests ministering to the Catholics in 6 counties. Well, since the nearest Catholic high school was Lexington Catholic, 120 miles away, this place met the 2 conditions. In the September of 1988, I was sent with just my personal belongings to eastern Kentucky. One of the 3 pastors said, well, you need a place to stay. So why not stay with me for the first year while you learn about the people, their customs, their culture, their background, their fears, their hopes. And I did. The following summer, a 2nd Piarist joins me. And now we've got to find a place of our own. But we were lucky because there's a group of Benedictine nuns in the area, and on the grounds in their monastery, they had a vacant house. And their superior said to me, why don't you move into that vacant house? And then, you can become our chaplain. Well, I hesitated for a moment, but she noticed that, and she quickly added, oh, you got to eat supper with us, too. I said, well. And there's an organization funded by a Catholic priest called the Christian Appalachian Project, which does a lot of good for the poor in eastern Kentucky. In 1984, they built a high school, but for a number of reasons, in 1988, it closed. And when they heard that we wanted to open up a high school, they approached us and said, we have a building. Would you be interested in leasing it for $1 a year? And of course, we took it. Now, why are these people, these organizations, and others like them, why have they gone out of their way to help us get established? There are 2 reasons. First, those who have been working on the poor in Appalachia for many years are convinced that the only way of ending the poverty that is there is by providing young people with a good education. So you can go away to good colleges and good universities and someday come back and help this area economically. That's a dream, but it's the only one they have. And very often, the public schools are not able to fulfill that dream, and it's not completely their fault because they don't have the tax base from which to work. In some areas of eastern Kentucky, 2/3 of all high school students drop out. They do so because they realize they're receiving a poor education, so what's the point of going to school? Or they don't know anybody in the coal industry or on the school board, so they're not going to get a job when they graduate. So attending classes is a waste of time. Or maybe their parents haven't gone past the sophomore year of high school. They feel they shouldn't go past the sophomore year of high school either. And the parents, because they're so afraid of their young leaving the area, don't discourage them. I became aware of this 1 month before our school first opened, when I spoke to an organization called the Rotary. And after speaking to them, there was a question and answer period. And there was one question that was asked that I will remember for the rest of my life because of the way it was asked. This is the question, and this is how it was asked. All you want to do is educate our children so they leave this area. Isn't that it? He said, no, we will provide them with a good education so they can go away to good colleges and good universities and hopefully someday come back and help this area economically. The person who asked that question was the editor of the local newspaper. 2 years later, he wrote it had to be a very painful editorial for which he acknowledged that their children are going to get their share of the American pie. They're going to have to go away to get it. And all the day the parents can do is keep the home fires burning, letting them know that they're always welcome back. Second reason people have helped us out is the spread of Catholic faith. If I asked you, what organized church do you think most of the people in Eastern Kentucky belong to? Most of you, if you're called part of the Bible Belt, would take a guess and say the Baptist Church. And to a certain degree, you're right. Most of the people in Eastern Kentucky that belong to an organized church belong to the Baptist Church. And in a survey done by the Southern Baptist Convention, in the county where I live, 89% of the population is unchurched. They don't belong to the Baptist Church, the Methodist Church, the Church of Christ, no church at all. And it kind of borders us in the north, 94% of the population is unchurched. And when I read that report, I went to a priest who really knew the people in their background. And they said, can you explain to me how 90% of the population is unchurched? And he said, you're forgetting the background of the people. And this background helps explain the fear the parents have of their young leaving the area. 95% of the population in Eastern Kentucky can trace their roots back to people who settled there before the Revolutionary War. They came over from England, Scotland, Ireland, and Germany, couldn't find work in cities like Baltimore and Philadelphia, so they moved into the Appalachian Mountains. And there they literally carved out an existence for themselves. But no priest were with them, no minister were with them. But there were people who knew their Bible, and today they still know their Bible. And they have a great love for Christ. And they call themselves Christians. It's just they don't bother belonging to a church. And yet, in this area, the Catholic Church is slowly growing. When we opened up our school, we made a decision that many people thought was foolish. We said there'll be no tuition. We thought we could do it because we were getting a building for $1 a year, and the Piarist Fathers themselves received absolutely no salary. But we thought that if we had a tuition of, let's say, $500 a year, then the people that couldn't pay that wouldn't apply, and we would be defeating our purpose of being here. And every year something happens to make us realize that we made the right decision. For instance, I often think of a girl named Jennifer who wanted to come to our school. But 2 weeks before school was to begin, I hadn't received her registration form. So I called her home. And I said, I haven't received Jennifer's registration form. So I said, we want to send it in, but you want $20 to go with it. And we don't have the $20. I said, forget about the $20. Just send in the registration form. In February of that school year, I had a chance to sit down and talk with Jennifer's mother. She said, you know, there's myself and my three daughters. We get $295 a month plus food stamps. But we have to pay our own electric bill. In January, our electric bill is $190, which left the four of us $105 plus the food stamps for the month. And yet we have lay teachers to pay utility bills to take care of school supplies, office supplies to purchase. We go out and pick up the students and bring them in, and they're not charged for transportation. We can't get the money from the people because they don't have it. We can't get it from the pastors of the parishes because they have to go out at times during the summer making appeals to get horse farms in the Lexington area. But two-thirds of the diocese is in Appalachia, and there are no farms there of any kind, just hills. And that's why I've come here. And I didn't come here just to ask for your help. I came here to beg for it. To beg that you be as generous as possible when the second collection is taken up today. But I want you to be clear about how that money is being used, and to break it down into three ways. First, to give young people. Whether they're Catholic or non-Catholic, and most of our students are non-Catholic, but they give them all a good college or preparatory education with the hope that someday, after graduating from college, after gaining some experience, they might be able to return to Eastern Kentucky and open up a business and employ 12 to 15 people. Last May, we had our 24th graduation. And I'm proud to say that every single member of those 24 graduating classes has been on to college. The second way in which we use this is spread around Catholic faith. We do this in many different ways, some of which we probably do here. Distribution of food, clothing. This one I'm sure you don't do here. Distribution of school supplies to teachers in the public schools. See, public schools have what they call their resource centers. And every year we get a phone call from one or two resource centers saying something like, we've run out of primary paper and our funding is run out. Can you help us? We'll send over primary paper to the resource center for them to give to the teachers in the public grade schools to use in the classroom. But most of all, we spread our Catholic faith by teaching it in the classroom. So that when a student goes home and somebody in the family or a neighbor says something against Catholics, they're able to correct them and say, no, Catholics don't believe that. And finally, some of it goes to help people in ways I never would have thought of before going to Eastern Kentucky. Like a man had telephoned one morning and explained that the pipe on his coal-burning stove got too hot for the night. And the roof caught on fire. They put the fire out, but they have a hole in their roof. Can we supply with sheet metal to cover that? They can do the work. We just didn't have the money for the sheet metal, and we did. We're all part of the mission church. You're here. You came in Appalachia. We're there. But we cannot do the work that God has called us to do without the help of people like you here. So please, when that second collection is taken up, be as generous as possible. And since I doubt if anybody here has ever heard of us before, and a couple of tables in the back are blue pamphlets like this, pick one up and leave. Take a look. And when you have a chance, read a little bit more about the Piarist Fathers and their history. On behalf of the Piarist who work with me,